Hello, everyone. My name is Todd Cochran, the host of The Chrome Show, found at thechromeshow.com. This is episode number two. And I guess before we get into episode number two, I want to take just a moment and apologize for all of you that checked out show number one, because we had some screen scaling issues on the last show, and I think we've got that figured out this show. So I hope that the online demos will be a lot more enjoyable for you. Hey, if you've got comments on The Chrome Show, you can very easily send us an email here at The Chrome Show by dropping email to chromeshow@gmail.com. Of course, you can follow me on Twitter at Geek News. And of course, The Chrome Show is part of the Geek News Central family of podcasts. And we hope that you'll get over to geeknewscentral.com and check out Geek News Central, Robot Underpants, The Gadget Professor, and a variety of other shows like the Saturday Morning Tech Show. So anyway, it's my pleasure to bring you the second episode of The Chrome Show. And I tell you, after having spent a lot of time working in the Chrome OS, I have determined a couple of things. As you get into the Chrome App Store and you start looking at the different apps that are available, many times what I'm finding is I say, oh, that looks pretty cool. I'll load it. And the app is nothing more than a link to someone's website. And in my definition, that really doesn't qualify as an app, because you would expect something to be kind of run natively in the browser that would be a different experience than what you would have when you go to someone's website. So what I would encourage is, if you are a Chrome app developer, if you have time and you feel like you would like to have us review your app, please send me an email, of course, here at the chromeshow.com, chromeshow@gmail.com. And I'll definitely take a look at your app and consider it for a review on the show. But so far, the response from the first episode has been good. A lot of you liked what you saw on the first show, minus the screen scaling issues. We've kind of got that handled today, and I'll just kind of give you an example here. So much, much larger screen, and really, it was very simple to solve. And I could have solved it on the last show, because all you have to do within the Chrome browser itself is press the control button and change the scale. So that's what we're going to be doing. And the reason for that is, is when you get the Chromebook, specifically the one that I have here, which is the Samsung Chromebook, there is no way to change the screen resolution on the external monitor. And what I have is I've got an external monitor hooked up into a converter that sends basically the signal over to the TriCaster so that you can see the screen. So that was a challenge that we had last week. Another thing I'm also finding with the Chrome browser and the Chrome OS is I'm getting a lot of Adobe Flash crashes. So I'll be on YouTube, or I'll be on a site that has Flash, and the actual app will crash, and we'll get that little note within the browser that Adobe has failed. And oftentimes it takes a complete reboot of the Chromebook, which, you know, is only like 8 seconds anyway to boot up. But by the time you shut it down and restart it, yeah, probably 30 seconds has elapsed. But anyway, it's a lot quicker than having to restart it, you know, probably just about as fast as shutting down the browser in your regular computer, then letting it clear the, you know, out of the cache and then let it reload. So not much difference there. But I definitely wasn't happy, or haven't been happy so far, with the number of Adobe Flash crashes. Now, I will say that I spent had the Chromebook with me all week. Specifically, I had it in the bedroom with me and was using it to cruise a variety of different websites at night. And, you know, I put it right down on the bedstand, shut the lid, and the next day come to it, open it up, boom, instant on, and I was on the internet. And I think that's what I'm finding to be very appealing about the Chromebook so far, is the ability to just really kind of grab it and be instant on no matter where you're at. And of course, with the Verizon EVDO connection as well, and the wireless connection, it's always connected, so long as you have a cell signal or you're available via Wi-Fi. So what I want to do today is, of course, remind you to make sure you get over to the chromeshow.com website. Check out the last show. Of course, you'll be able to subscribe to iTunes now. There is an iTunes subscription link on the website, so make sure you get subscribed to that. And, of course, you can pick it up on the RSS feed as well. So you'll notice here what I've got set up. I've got just basically going into the apps area. And I want to show you a couple of interesting things that I have found while I have been perusing the web store. And I want to caution you that some of these apps would have been better left unpublished because of their, for better words, lack of refinement. And you'll see kind of some of those in the beginning. Now, one thing I want to show you, though, is when you get apps on the actual app bar, if you get sick of an app, now this one here was one I loaded. It was called Day Zipping. And it wasn't that compelling of an app. So I decided, oh, I'm going to go ahead and get rid of it. And there's a little bar. And let me zoom in as close as we can so you can kind of see that. Let me scroll down here so you can see the, I'll focus in on this. You'll see there's a little bar there, right? So all you got to do is click that. And the bar opens up, and you go ahead and say uninstall, and you uninstall it, and it'll just bounce right out. So that's kind of the easy way to get set up and control what is going on in the app area. Just a little tip on using the actual Chrome OS. Now, another thing I found was oftentimes you may be on a Wi-Fi connection where you don't necessarily want a lot of information going over that network that you may consider to be private. So what you have in the upper right-hand corner is in the toolbar area. If I click that and open it up, there's a selection that says New Incognito Window. And if I click on this, what this does is this opens up a new browser. And it says You've Gone Incognito. And let me kind of zoom in here so you guys can see what this says. It says pages you view in this window won't appear in your browser history or search history, and they won't leave other traces like cookies on your computer after you close the incognito window. Any files you've downloaded or bookmarks you create will be preserved, however. Going incognito doesn't affect the behavior of other people's servers or software, so be wary of websites that collect or share information about you, internet service providers and employers that track the pages you visit, malicious software, of course, surveillance by secret agents. They really have that in there. But anyway, there's more information to find out about incognito. So it was kind of cool because if you want to, you know, basically you're on a Wi-Fi connection maybe you don't trust, or you're going to a web page for the first time that you don't know about, and you want to just be a little bit more careful, going into the incognito mode. To get out of that mode is very simple. In the top right-hand column of the website, and I know you can't see this because it's too far off the page, is the ability to basically, it's a stacked window, and you click that, and it brings you back to the app box. So that's just one of the small tips I have for you in using the Chrome OS. I've loaded a couple of standard browser extensions. One here up the top is the ability to bring up the dictionary, and I like this a lot, and let me see if I can come in and actually zoom over there so you guys can see this. Basically, all I got to do is define something. So if I want to, let me type in a word here and see if they can find the definition of a podcast. So let me just put in podcast in here, and I go ahead and hit define it. And it does. It gives me the definition of the word podcast, a multimedia digital file made available on their net for downloading to a portable media player, computer, etc. And it gives me the definition, gives me the web definition, some links, the Wikipedia, and different types of articles that are available out as well. So I really did like the ability to use the actual dictionary in this lookup to be able to define words and get a better idea on certain things. And what this is really good for is how many times have you had your kids come in and say, hey, Dad, can you let me know what this word means, or can you define this for me? And all you really have to do is, if they're running the Chrome OS browser, is go ahead and tell them to use the Google Dictionary. And this is available via the web store under Google Dictionary. Another thing that I found that I like is, of course, is Google Voice. And many of you have a Google Voice account. So the Google Voice extension is real easy to install. It's available via the web store. And when you click on it, it opens up a little box that basically gives you the information about what's been going on and calls that have been coming into you. So you can play your voicemails in here, or you can read the transcriptions that they've done from text messages. And I actually had a marketeer call me about 3 weeks ago and leave a message. It was basically a sales pitch. So you can manage your Google Voice inbox right here within the browser, And that way you don't have to have a, you know, you don't have to go anywhere else. You don't have to go over to Google Voice directly and manage stuff. This was a voicemail that came in. It was a 2-second one. So there really was nothing, but you can see that it will try to play even though there was nothing there. So that's kind of a cool thing about being able to pick up Google Voice. And it's, again, an extension you can add at the top right-hand column of the website. Let's talk about a few applications that I've loaded this week for you to check out. The first one is Beat the Boot. This is kind of a cool thing that Google has put together, and you got to pay attention to this because it's quick. So when you load Beat the Boot, it loads an app from the App Store, and it takes a few seconds for it to load here. Let's see if we can zoom into it to make sure that you can see the whole thing once it gets booted up. So basically, Chromebooks boot up in just 8 seconds. What can you accomplish in that time? So let's play the number one player, the one player Lee. And they're going to go ahead and give me a game here to play. And it's kind of random, so you never know what you're going to get. What color is this? Well, it's white. So what am I supposed to do? Okay. What color is a drawing? I have to use the right or left buttons once we get the thing here. So it's going to give me the first game here. Here we go. Okay. Okay, that's obviously white. It's... Uh-oh, I got it wrong. I was clicking the thing, but it obviously was kicking my butt here. But anyway, it's just a cool little game you can play to beat the boot. And it's available, of course, via the web app store. So let me go ahead and switch back to the regular page here. Oh, where are we at? There we go. Next thing I want to show you here is called localshow.tv. And when this started to load, I thought this has potential here. And what this is music videos and nearby concerts. And it, you know, doesn't look like a regular website when it loads. And it'll take here just a second, but it comes up and starts playing media immediately. And I'm going to pause the media that's playing. And what I want to do here is I want to scroll down and actually show you guys what this has done. So you can go down here and select channel. And you can pick a location in the United States. So if you live in a major city, it doesn't have Honolulu in here. So let's see what's going on, for example, in Detroit. So if I click Detroit and I say all music and upcoming and pick a time frame. Obviously, there's nothing in what's going on in Detroit. Oh, Cobra Starship. There's something up there at the top. You can buy a ticket here. Or you can pick an artist if you're looking for a specific artist. So here is a update of where Cobra Starship is going to be. And they talk about different venues that they're going to be in. So if you're into finding different events and finding out what's going on in your city, this might be a good app for you to check out. Again, it's called localshow.tv. If I come back to the browser here and I go in and I load this application called Shortform, this is an example of an app that I wasn't super impressed with. So it basically, when you clicked on it, all it really did was loaded the website. All right. So it really didn't load an app. So, okay, how compelling is that? It's not super compelling. So all right, while I'm here, let's go ahead and check it up. So it says YouTube hits, the most popular videos on YouTube today. So I'm going to go ahead and click that and see what we get. And then this is an issue. Now watch this. If it does the same thing it did earlier, it's going to say, this video you requested, Katy Perry last Friday night, is not available. So I went through and it looks for different videos, and all of a sudden these videos are not available, one after the other. So one thing that the folks over at Google really need to do, I'm serious, what they really need, they need to get a handle on this, because this was an application that was in the recommended section that was being recommended by the folks at Google as something that was, I would consider, they thought was extraordinary, but it was not. So when it comes to these types of apps, you kind of are really kind of just at this point, from what I'm seeing so far, is you are, to a certain extent, kind of just luck of the draw on if you find one. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to go ahead and reach right in there, and I'm going to remove that from the lineup because it really wasn't worth something to look at. Now, one thing that I did find that was a little bit cool was a application called News Squares. And what this one allowed you to do is basically it shows you, it goes to your, ties into your Reader account, your Google Reader account, and it basically lists stuff that's in your timeline about what's been going on in the news, and it kind of gives you a quick look. So if I want to click on Hacker News, for example, and this is an article that says a Cobra Effect Lionfish Style, and I click on this, what happens at the very bottom of the page, let me close this because I didn't hover over that. At the bottom of the page, you'll see, and I'm going to zoom on this a little bit, see if I can do that. At the bottom of the page, then there's a bubble down here. It says, Eric Schmidt, you don't know it's a bubble until the bubble ends. And this is something that was on Hacker News. So if I click on that, then it opens up another link. But the thing that I was concerned about, sometimes you actually had to click and go into the actual article itself. It all depended on what was available in the RSS feed, what was going to get populated in this box. So while I could click on that and it would take me over to TechCrunch, really this particular article didn't give me very much information on what it was about, just a title, right? But when I was on the CNET website, if I click on this bubble here up in the top left-hand corner, and it says, man has QR. Okay, see here, you see at this point, it brings up a little bit of information about the article. So if I want to click on this, I can go over then to the HP, this article about HP that's been discussed here in brevity on CNET. Now, what they should really do with this, in my opinion, News Squares could be really improved by making it a much more interactive experience and having more detail. If I click on the Gizmodo link, it keeps giving me tips here on things I can do. So let me click on this. Okay. On this one, there's a little bit more information from Gizmodo. It's kind of like a summary. But again, very little information is provided. So I don't know if this is faster than actually going to Reader itself. It might be a quick way for you to find content. This continues to roll off the screen and stuff gets, it gets rearranged as new stuff comes into it. So it might be worthy for you to check this out. But if you're used to using Google Reader or other applications, there may be a better or even a better website out there for you. Kind of a fun thing is this graffiti application. And this is really one of the first time as a real graffiti. So I'm going to say, my name is Todd. I'm going to put this in here. Whoops, I got to type in on the right keyboard. Let me blow this up for you so you can see it. So I'm putting here Todd. We'll tab over and we'll put in my email, geeknews@g. Oops, no, that was nice. @gmail.com. And who am I going to send this to? I'll send this to myself at another address I have. And then I can use the graffiti to draw and just draw anything I want. And we can start up here and say, hi. And then you do whatever you want to do with this. So it's kind of, just a little dumb graffiti drawing thing. And when you're done, you can go ahead and click it and it'll send graffiti and it'll send them a picture. So it all depends on how good your web skills are, whether or not you can make a good use of this. Might be fun for the kids to send you a little note from their account versus you sending a non-adult picture to another person. Another app that I loaded was the ability to go over to Zillow. So if any of you are shopping for homes, the Zillow app seemed pretty cool because it brings you into the Zillow ecosphere here. And let me blow this up so you can see this a little better. And I've loaded my area of the country and where I live here in Honolulu. And I can see all the houses that are for sale in and amongst my area. And can zoom in and get pricing and everything that you would expect from the Zillow website, along with looking at specific listings as well. You can load up stuff and get information here right in with the app. So while this has a lot of functionality that you can see at the regular Zillow website, I did notice it was smart enough to know where I was located and put that information in there automatically. So just a few things I wanted to share with you today on the Chrome Show. Those are a few of the apps that I have found, and we'll continue to dig and find more tips. I do want to leave you with one last thing, and something I haven't really found a use for yet. If you go over to the toolbar, and it's again up in the top right-hand corner, there's a selection here that says Tools, and then there's the File Manager. And this loads a new page, and the page really doesn't have a lot of information on it, except that it says File Shelf and External Storage. So this is the way that you can stick a SD card into the computer and actually bring in photos into the system. You also can get access to files that are actually on the computer itself. But up to this point, I haven't downloaded anything to put in these specific folders. But it loads it as a tab, so it just shows up as another browser tab. And just another cool thing I found within the Chrome OS that's a little different than anything you would normally see on a regular Chrome browser running in the actual on your actual PC versus in a Chromebook. If you've got suggestions, again, send them over to chromeshow@gmail.com. If you have comments on today's show, send me an email, geeknews@gmail.com, or call our voicemail, chromeshow@gmail.com. Call our voicemail hotline at 619-342-7365. Until next time, for the Crow Show, my name is Todd Cochran. Take care and aloha.